My name is Marc Firth. I'm VP of Engineering at Jellyfish. I've been working here about 6 years now, and in the industry about 12 years. I oversee the software and data engineering teams here at Jellyfish, working on a variety of projects, including data warehousing. And I'm going to talk to you about how you can fuel insights using a GCP data warehouse to essentially drive that performance that you're looking for. So taking a step back, so by 2021, insight-driven businesses are predicted to take $1.8 trillion annually from their less informed peers. And the way that this is going to come about, essentially, is through the use of data, having the best data, doing the processing to drive the right messaging at the right time to the right audience. And doing so, you would do so with a data warehouse, essentially, at the core. So if you look at Wikipedia definition of a data warehouse, it says a data warehouse, also known as an enterprise data warehouse, is a system used for reporting and data analysis, and is considered a core component of business intelligence. Data warehouses are central repositories of integrated data from one or more disparate sources. But what does this actually mean in real terms? So essentially, we are collecting our data sources, pulling the data from those using a variety of pipeline scripts and tools, feeding that into our data warehouse and storing it in a structure that's useful to us, so that then we can drive collaboration, we can trigger actions such as remarketing, and drive insights through our dashboards. We can use our machine learning off the back of these as well. So data-driven organizations are 23 times more likely to acquire customers than their peers. And essentially, it is the insights and the machine learning that's going to be pushing the change here. So what would an example data warehouse look like? So on example on GCP, so we've mentioned a few of these tools already. Ben mentioned in his talk. So essentially, we tend to go through this same process in that we collect the data, transform it, analyze, and then we can visualize and activate once we have it in a form that's useful. So this could be that we're collecting data from a variety of sources, such as marketing campaigns, Google Analytics. We could be loading this data hourly, nightly, whatever it might be, in batch. And we might be collecting real-time order data as well. So this is essentially streaming data. And the good thing with Google Cloud Dataflow is that we can process both the streaming and batch using the same pipelines, which allows us to basically reduce the amount of work we have to do, essentially. So we pull our data in using tools like BigQuery storage for our files and PubSub for our real-time events, and join those together in a pipeline that's running on Cloud Dataflow. We can also use some other tools there. So Data Prep, for instance, helps us with designing those pipelines so that we can use a visual kind of drag and drop interface, which allows us to quickly create those recipes for transformation, essentially. Then from Dataflow, we now have our joined streaming and batch data. We can drop that into BigQuery. BigQuery being our inexpensive, reliable data storage location. Essentially, when it's in BigQuery, it's in a location that is easily shareable, essentially, because it's in the database, and we can query that with SQL. And SQL is becoming more and more widely used amongst many teams other than just the DB admins, essentially. From BigQuery, we can then start using the APIs. So we can use the things like the ML APIs, natural language. We can feed that into our notebooks, a data lab or AI notebooks, allow us to explore that data and do our analysis and see the potential pieces that we might want to apply machine learning to. And we can build out our models and host those on Cloud AI platform, which will essentially give us a location where we can kind of version our machine learning models, and we can have those hosted in a production-ready environment so that we can kind of call them as when we want to. And to get the data, obviously all of this, there's quite a lot of tasks going on here, moving data around. As you mentioned before, Cloud Composer is the piece that basically orchestrates all of this together. So this enables us to kind of schedule those tasks. When do we want to kind of pull data from this data source and drop it into this sync, essentially. So then we can go through and we can share our data through Google Sheets and BigQuery. You can export straight to Google Sheets. So for anyone who wants to take a look at the data but perhaps doesn't know SQL, you can export into Google Sheets. Obviously, if they know SQL, then you can just share the data set from BigQuery itself. And then we can use visualization tools like Data Studio or Looker. This allows us to then have that dashboard so we can actually see a little easier what is going on. And finally, we have our external services. So we can, once we've got our insights and we've created our customer segments or whatever it might be, we can then push the result off to the external APIs to then trigger an action like remarketing or similar. So we get asked this question quite a lot. Should we build a data warehouse? And I would say that this is actually the wrong question to ask. And I'm going to explain why. So the key thing is that you really want to understand your business challenges first. So what is it that is essentially holding back your business? So we have these things like the digital transformation. You can kind of see how far along that transformation you are. So you might have things like, we don't know what type of messaging works best, for instance. Or we don't know, we don't have an understanding of our customer lifetime value. We don't know if a customer is likely to convert or not, or we don't provide that personal experience in our marketing. So once you've understood what your business challenges are, you can then start going through and figuring out what opportunities you have. So if we, for instance, if we don't know what type of marketing messaging works best, we could see, could we push our ads through image detection to essentially extract the features of that ad, like how many of our products were in that ad, what colors were in there, what text was used, what messaging, essentially. We could, if we don't know if a customer is likely to convert or not, we could use behavioral data from Google Analytics or similar to identify users that are likely to convert. And we could use, if we don't provide a personal experience, we could use the data on the products that other customers have bought to show similar products. So then once you have those, you need to basically see what data actually supports those opportunities. So for the ads, we could use a vision API to extract that information. For the identifying users who are likely to convert, we could use our Google Analytics behavioral data. And finally, for looking to see if there are similar items others have bought, we can use the GA data or our CRM or order data and pull that into our data warehouse, essentially. So the data itself, you need to get a bit of understanding about kind of where it is, what does it actually contain, who actually owns that data, so how are you going to get access to it, who is the person in your organization who knows that data set best, and any known problems. Will it require cleansing? And then you have four types of data, essentially. You have the data that you already have and analyze. You have data you collect but you don't analyze. Data you could collect but you aren't currently. And data from third parties that you could buy, essentially. Now, data you collect but don't analyze, usually this is because it's a bit more difficult to process. So it could be that it's images or video or something that's unstructured and not easy to decipher, essentially. But this is where cloud tools like the Vision API can come into play and start helping you with that processing, extracting that information. Now, this process of going from business challenges to the actual tasks you need to undertake is something that we've actually packaged up into a workshop. So this is my sales slide for the day. Essentially, it's a one-day immersive workshop to walk through, basically taking you from understanding what your business challenges are, identifying a roadmap of tasks and essentially driving that, how you're going to get from where you are to where you want to be, defining what the clear success criteria are, and looking at, okay, so which of these opportunities is going to deliver the most value for the minimum effort, essentially, or time. And once you've got that, then you can start roadmapping that out. And we also include some inspirational success stories as well. So I would say that the goal should not be to build a data warehouse, but to work to resolve your business challenges and activate your data instead. In fact, I did say it. So we have a, once you've got all your tasks, you can essentially then start planning out your roadmap. So what you want to do is obviously focus on those tasks that deliver the most value in the shortest amount of time. And for some of those more complex tasks, maybe look at, can we break those down and actually just start with something smaller? Can we essentially create a minimum viable product? You want to identify what KPIs are for each one of those tasks so that you can prioritize them. You can measure them afterwards and understand whether or not they've been a success. And obviously you want to know that up front so that you can actually plan out what you want to do. And then reprioritize quarterly, because business challenges change over time. So you want to have an agile team essentially that's able to respond to that change and change what you're working on essentially to fit what the business is facing. So you want to expect that change. And finally, include change management processes. So this is where essentially portions of your business are going to change the way your staff are working with the data. They're going to have access to more data than they had before. Maybe some of their roles are going to be automated. So what you want to do is include change management processes, essentially making sure that they have an understanding of what is changing, understanding of how their roles might change, maybe sending like email notifications on kind of the progress of the projects, or having an open session where they can come in and understand kind of the, what it means for them, essentially. And when you've broken down your tasks, you can then start working through in sprints. So you have a backlog of all the things you want to do, and you know you have a team size, four people, however many it is, and you work through in sprints, basically selecting the key tasks that are the highest priority, and then review them again. Can we break these down into smaller tasks, MVP, do a proof of concept, just to prove the value of what it is you're trying to do? And obviously plan, test, benchmark, get your results. When you're happy, deploy to production, and then iterate over time. You want to optimize and iterate, especially with machine learning. Obviously the first instance of the model is probably going to be one of the worst. You can add new data over time. You can improve the feature engineering. You can essentially do, train it with more data as well. You should focus on your insights and not your infrastructure. And this is why we recommend using GCP. Essentially, it's a serverless environment. So the key thing you want to focus on is those insights and analytics. But if you're spending, if your team is spending all their time managing the infrastructure, handling growing scale, maybe you've got more data now that you need to process. So it means you need to go out and buy more servers. You need to install the software on those servers. You need to do all these other things. You don't want to be doing that. Just use serverless tools, software as a service, focus on your insights and analytics. And the majority of this is handled for you. Okay, there is little pieces you'll have to do, but in, on the most part, it is handled. And obviously security comes as standard and you get that whole suite of tools that work together. So as we saw in that data warehouse slide with the Cloud Composer and BigQuery and the orchestration. The reason we choose BigQuery is because it's a petabit scale database. It's inexpensive, durable, long-term data storage. You can, essentially when you're doing your processing, so you'll run a query, and the reason BigQuery is so fast with such big data sets is because it will take your, it has your query in your data set, and essentially what BigQuery will do is distribute that processing. So it's this concept of map reduce, and this is a paper that Google wrote, I think it was back in 2004 or something, but it is the process of taking a portion of processing, distributing it amongst many machines, so they can all handle a small chunk of that processing and then joining together the result at the end so that you get the result in less time, essentially. And it's a durable data store, familiar SQL syntax, so even those who aren't in the engineering team are using BigQuery across our business, many of our customers' businesses. And it's secure and there is immutable audit logs as well. So essentially, you'll always know who did what and when, because those logs cannot be changed. So you feed in all your data from all your sources, your social data, batch data, order data, messaging, and from the back of that, you get your insights, machine learning, collaboration, etc. So here's one we made earlier, Softonic Data Warehouse. So we're here, we unified, so Softonic had a problem, basically they had all these individual data sets that they couldn't understand kind of where customers touched. So what were the touch points for the customers on the services? So we unified these 22 data sources into BigQuery to create a 360 degree customer view. And off the back of this, essentially, so again, actually with this, APIs were being fed through data flow, pub sub, the same routine as before, as I showed, just slightly different diagram, into BigQuery. And then from that, we're getting our visualizations in Data Studio. They were triggering their machine learning pipelines and actually activating off the back of that as well. And this led to an 80% increase in click-through rates. And also because all of this reporting that they were previously running manually in separate teams was now automated on this platform, essentially it reduced their operational overheads, freeing their IT staff to focus on generating new insights and such. But it doesn't have to be that complex. So you can start with something far simpler. Propensity model, for instance. This is something we do quite regularly, and getting the result of the propensity is usually about a 3-week time scale. Obviously, you can then integrate it with a variety of sources afterwards. But essentially, you can use this to drive your sales and return on investment. So you take the behavioral data from your website, feed it into BigQuery, put it through a propensity model running in TensorFlow, the machine learning library, and hosted on the cloud AI platform. And we consistently feed in new data to continue training that model and improve that model and engineer new features. And once we've got that, the results for how likely a customer is to convert, if they're kind of definitely going to convert, then we don't need to market to them. If they're maybe likely with a little push they're going to convert, then we can start pushing additional messaging to them. And if they're not going to convert, then maybe we don't market to them or we change our message, essentially. Maybe they need to know a bit more about the company first. And yeah, you can feed that into your email remarketing ads, your CRM, maybe for your sales teams, or social marketing as well. So 1 billion is the amount that Netflix saved in 2017 by using machine learning to make personalized recommendations. You may have seen it in the interface. If you've got Netflix, sometimes the tiles for each show, they change over time. So you'll notice that the images change. Essentially, that's the machine learning happening in the background. It's personalizing and changing what it thinks you're most likely to want, essentially. They've got a number of personalization models that they have going on. They have a huge data science team. But yeah, they're making those personalized recommendations to drive that engagement. And yeah, the savings are obviously huge. You've also got chatbots, which people don't often think about for marketing. So Spotify, for instance, they're using their chatbot to recommend what music to listen to. So what genre of music might you like to listen to? Domino's Pizza, so they have you can see there the ads for the individual products in the bot. So you can go in, you can actually see what you want and click on it. And then you can order through that discussion with the bot and actually fulfill that order through directly in the chatbot. And then finally, the last one is NFL. So it is the online video service for them. This is actually a chatbot that Jellyfish built. It's an information bot so they can understand how they can see different shows, what devices they can see the shows on. Gives them help. They can rate the bot so we can actually understand how well that bot is doing. And if it doesn't answer their question, it will forward them to an actual advisor as well. 63% of users prefer to message a chatbot versus talk with a human when communicating with a business, apparently. We've had some interesting discussions about this number, but it's essentially more and more of our, especially our younger generations, are connecting with chatbots when communicating with a business. And there's a whole range of ML use cases that can be applied So whether it be kind of predicting which products to show to an individual user, routing emails based on natural language to the right department, essentially, so they can respond to faster, doing our demand forecasting, our lifetime value, dynamic website content, dynamic pricing, looking at our messaging and creatives to optimize those as well. So a C4M data warehouse, so we would essentially be pulling data from all of these sources, as we mentioned. We're triggering actions, we're generating our dashboards so we can actually see what's going on. We're feeding our machine learning models, pushing data externally so we can trigger those actions, such as automating our marketing, and overall improving that customer experience. So what would this actually look like for the various streams of data? For social data, you could be identifying your influencers, posting alerts, automating responses. For your sales data, you could have your marketing driven by ML-based demand forecasting, maybe looking at external factors there as well. Your web analytics, automated remarketing again, dynamic content and messaging, emails, detecting the sentiment and routing to the correct teams, auto-replying to those emails. Your stock levels, maybe you could use those inside your marketing. There's no point marketing a product that's out of stock, for instance. And CRM data, so identifying trends, segmenting your users, and targeting those users as well. So 87% of companies plan to use ML in sales forecasting and email marketing by 2021, which means it's more than the majority. So the winners are going to be the ones who are truly generating the best insights and making the best use of the data that they have, building the best models and growing that service.